The Kem Kem formation of Cretaceous North Africa was one of the deadliest environments in Earth's history. It was packed with gigantic carnivorous theropods like few other geological formations could dream of, ranging from bear-sized abelisaurids to giant heron-crocs like Spinosaurus to sauropod hunters like Carcharodontosaurus. There was one paper from 2016 that suggested these animals all belonged to separate layers, but as far as I'm aware, the idea hasn't gained any traction since then, so we're going to go traditional and treat them as living in the same time and place. Could Tyrannosaurus rex, the theropod king of North America, survive in this harsh, competitive environment? We'll be calculating a Thrive or Eaten Alive score from 1 to 10, based on its performance in three categories. Home, or how it adapts to the new climate and terrain, hunger, how it finds food, and hanger, how it deals with competitors. I normally say predators as well, but this is T-Rex, man. Good luck with that. And don't forget to check out the first Hybrids vs. Aliens video, which was recently posted on Overseer's channel. Madly Mesozoic, Overseer, and I have spent the better part of a year working on this series, and we're really proud of it. Home. To understand how T-Rex would adapt to the environs of Cenomania North America, 30 million years and a continent away from where it grew up, we need to look at its own stomping grounds first. Tyrannosaurus rex is known from multiple late Cretaceous formations in North America, including the swampy, forested floodplains of Hell Creek, the bayou of the Lance Formation, and the southern plains with vast, semi-arid stretches of land that made up the Northhorn and Javelina formations. Tyrannosaurus macrayensis is from the Hall Lake Formation of New Mexico, and there is some doubt as to the species' legitimacy. If it's just another rex, it would expand their range yet again. T-Rex would have been quite capable of navigating both humid wetland environments as well as more desert-like locations, using trees to mask its movements visually and the soft ground to hide its rumbling footsteps. So what about the Kem Kem? Technically, the Kem Kem is made up of multiple smaller formations, but since they're typically lumped together for the purposes of common conversation and reference, we'll do the same here for simplicity. It's a delta environment, where river systems empty sediment and water into the Cretaceous Ocean. A 2020 study found that the plant life mainly consisted of complete leaves and fronds of herbaceous and woody plants, including ferns, ginkgos, gymnosperms, and angiosperms. That's broadly similar to the formations that T-Rex would have been familiar with, and with a comparable warm, humid atmosphere. It also provides plenty of opportunities with large trees to set up ambushes for whatever prey animals it may encounter here. What's more, the Hell Creek Formation already bordered the Western Interior Seaway, so being next to an ocean filled with large fish and spooky sea predators isn't exactly unexplored territory. The Tyrant Lizard King gets a 9 out of 10 for home. There are no practical differences on a large scale between portions of its Maastrichtian origin and the seaside, forested wetlands of the Kem Kem. It's just a different flavor of the same environment, a new land that it's ready to lord over as king of the reptilian beasts. And if you want to conquer territory yourself, I recommend playing today's sponsor, Beast Lord the New Land. Beast Lord is an animal-themed strategy mobile game with multiple strategy types based on the animals you choose. There are over 500 animal types to pick from, and the game has both a realistic painting style as well as vivid, defined roles for each animal. And I'm a huge animal nerd, so I was happy to learn that Beast Lord isn't just a game about battling and expansion of territory. It also includes an animal encyclopedia entry for each of its critters, so you can make it educational. The coolest parts about this game are the alphas, like my personal favorite, the saltwater crocodile. Salties are powerful semi-aquatic apex predators from Oceania, reaching up to 6 meters long and over 1,000 kilograms. They're the largest living reptiles, and have thick armor along with a powerful bite. An alpha's in-game mechanics represent its real-life abilities, so the saltie has abilities like dual bite and fatal raid to show its strength as an ambush predator. Komodo dragons are another of my favorite animals, and they're also available as powerful alphas. They secrete venom-like proteins in their saliva and can take down prey as large as buffalo by themselves. Its invincible overlord ability creates your omnivore attack power and can do massive additional damage with its poison strike ability. Those are definitely the two alphas I'd recommend aiming for if you're a representative of big reptile like me. There's also an extensive tutorial that helps you collect resources to start out the game. Download Beastlord using my link in the description and pinned comment, and redeem the special code BL777 to help with early development. Hunger. In order to conquer this particular new land, Tyrannosaurus rex will need to find reliable food sources. Back home, it chiefly dined on Edmontosaurus adnectins, a fast, elephant-sized hadrosaurid, as well as big ceratopsians like Triceratops and Torosaurus, each of which ranged from 5 to 10 plus tons. 4-ton Ankylosaurus was also a potential food option, although it probably wasn't worth the trouble most of the time. And while no sauropods are known from the Hell Creek Formation, T-Rex did coexist with the 40-ton Titanosaur Alamosaurus sanjuanensis when we look at the Northhorn and Javelina formations. there's kind of a weird stigma online against the idea of T-Rex hunting sauropods for whatever reason, but considering the isotopic studies show that its close relative Tarbosaurus did just fine hunting sauropods, I don't see a legitimate reason why T-Rex, which was twice the size of Tarbo, wouldn't have been perfectly capable of taking down a Titanosaur every now and again. Lautenschlager 2015 demonstrated that T-Rex had a wide maximum gape for its huge jaws, so it's not even like an adult Alamosaurus would be too big to bite. Not that it would go out of its way to focus on adults, of course, given the sheer size difference, but it's certainly not impossible like Paleo Twitter likes to pretend it is. An adult Rex would be able to take down a juvenile Alamosaurus pretty easily, and possibly even a sub or young adult. That's not accounting for gregariousness, of course, which seems to be fairly well supported in large Tyrannosaurs. Well supported for a fossil taxon anyway, given the levels of uncertainty involved in these sorts of things, will account for both possibilities here. The prey profile of the Kem Kem is surprisingly similar to that of Maastrichtian Laramidia. There are plenty of interesting animals here that wouldn't be worth hunting from a practicality or net calorie perspective. Araripusuchus and the other crocodilians are either too small, too fast, or too watery. There's about a dozen fragmentary pterosaur species that would be flying around and might be crunchable snacks if caught unawares or injured. The river systems also contain giant fish like Oncopristus, a 2 to 3 meter sawfish, as well as Mausonia, a coelacanth the size of a car. I doubt that T-Rex would turn down one of these if it somehow ended up on the shore of a river, but it's probably not going into the water after them. The similarities really begin with the dinosaurs. There's some kind of thyreophoran, possibly an ankylosaur, in the Kem Kem known from a tooth. While likely heavily armored, its small size would make it fairly easy to take on, especially if T-Rex approached from the front and bit the head off. There are also large ornithopod tracks from the area implying an iguanodon-sized animal, which would readily fill the niche that Edmontosaurus did back home. Robocosaurus garazbe was a decent-sized sauropod, estimated at 14 meters long and weighing 7 to 12 tons. This would be a phenomenal prey item. It's about the same size as a T-Rex, but has no comparable weaponry. A lone Rex could easily dispatch a fully grown Robocosaurus or take advantage of a herd, picking off weak, slow, or injured individuals to save on precious foraging energy. The crown jewel of the Kem Kem in terms of large prey is the Paralotitan-sized Titanosaur, which we'll call Denethor for no particular reason. A 2016 paper shows its scale, and man is this thing big, whether reconstructed as a derived or basal Titanosaur. It's either somewhat larger than Robocosaurus, or way larger than Robocosaurus, easily comparable to Dreadnoughtus. Tyrannosaurus would absolutely go ham when presented with either small or injured individuals, and if it did in fact hunt in groups as its relatives seem to imply, could have taken on fully grown healthy Denethors if necessary. There really aren't any notable issues here in terms of the menu. If anything, it's easier to hunt sauropods here, whose only weapon is their size, than it is to hunt giant, fast, armored prey back home. Tyrannosaurus gets a 9 out of 10 for hunger, only missing a point because sampling biases of the Kem Kem haven't preserved a ton of herbivores very well. Clearly the prey items are there, even if taphonomy is a jerk. Hanger. Now for the section of the video that most of you probably clicked on it for, and I don't blame you. While Tyrannosaurus rex obviously wouldn't have to deal with predation as an adult, hatchlings and young rexes would be in constant danger, and adults would need to face competition from the native apexes. Let's go over the threats that the formations of the Kem Kem have to offer and how they might make T-Rex's life difficult. Sauroniops is one of the best names ever for a theropod dinosaur, and it makes me sad that the material is total crap. That's right, it's a single frontal bone, which explains why it's named after the Eye of Sauron, but holy cow, that's a laughably bad holotype. There is a pair of fused frontals, described and referred to Sauroniops by Cow and Paterna 2025, showing it had a thickened skull roof, but it's still quite fragmentary. We have no idea of how large the theropod would have been other than decently sized. Anywhere from 7 to 12 meters is possible. The informal genus, Osteoporosia, has also been suggested to represent a junior synonym of Sauroniops, which would add a tooth and a fragment of a vertebra. There's not enough to say anything other than there was a medium-sized possible Carcharodontosaur running around that may have threatened young T-Rexes. There are also indeterminate fragments of abelisaurids, but I can't find much information about them. Bahariosaurus is better. Actually, it's worse. A bunch of different fragments are referred to it from over 30 localities, but the holotype was bombed to bits in World War II. With only drawings left, it's been identified as an indeterminate celerosaur, a megaraptoran, and most recently as a beaked herbivorous elaphrosaur. It's decently large, regardless of the reconstruction, at up to 4 tons, but I wouldn't say we know enough about the animal to state how it would affect an invasive Tyrannosaurus population, if at all. What about the Megatheropod fight that created theropod flame wars in the first place? Spinosaurus. Would Jack Horner's Jurassic Park 3 fantasy play out all over again, with Spinosaurus easily overpowering the much smaller Tyrannosaurus? Well, if you're watching this video, you probably know that more Spinosaurus material uncovered from 2014 to 2020 showed that the animal had a long paddle tail and shorter hind limbs than previously thought. The subadult specimen is about 11 meters long and weighs 3.4 tons. Larger fragments exist that may or may not belong to Spinosaurus, but certainly belong to a large North African Spinosaurine, so to be generous in this video, we'll give them to the genus. A. Would Spinosaurus threaten T-Rex? And B. If it did, could Spinosaurus come out on top? The answer to the first question is no. Spinosaurus likely lived as a shoreline and shallows predator, capturing large fish with its powerful jaws and claws, while occasionally taking terrestrial prey as well. The biomechanics of its swimming ability are still heavily debated, but I'm sure it would at least be able to move around in the large rivers of the Kem Kem. It already lived and successfully niche partitioned with a big terrestrial carnivore we'll cover in a moment, so honestly, there would be no reason for it to want to confront a T-Rex and vice versa. And if they did fight, it would have to be over something truly important, a resource they both desperately needed and were willing to risk injury over. I very strongly doubt that would ever happen, unless you had two starving megatheropods encounter one another next to a juicy sauropod corpse or something. If it came to a true close quarters fight on land, I don't think there's any question that Spinosaurus is getting eaten alive. The very largest, somewhat reasonable Spinosaurus specimens, MSNM B4047 and NHM UKR 16421, scale to animals 14 to 15 meters long and 7.5 to 8.5 tons. Mass-wise, that's comparable to an average Tyrannosaurus adult, but the weaponry is not. Tyrannosaurus has such a height advantage that Spinosaurus wouldn't be able to use its claws to swipe, given its limited range of motion, and a single bite from T-Rex ends the confrontation. This isn't a fight. It's a predation event. Carcharodontosaurus saharicus would likely be a much more relevant threat. While quite fragmentary, known only from a 1.6 meter skull, it's a large theropod by any reasonable definition. Anywhere from 11 to 12.5 meters long and 7 to 8.5 tons is a realistic estimate based on more complete relatives. Carcharodontosaurus has long, thin teeth, excellent for slicing right through flesh to inflict quick damage, and a bite force at the front of the mouth of 11,000 newtons. Its skull was also very lightweight, which helped it bite more quickly. It had limited binocular vision and would have needed to hold its head at a downward angle to more accurately judge distances, so may have approached its prey from higher ground or at an oblique angle, or to have held its head as such when hunting. When tracking large, slow-moving sauropods, more focused vision isn't necessary. You're basically hunting a billboard. A typical adult Tyrannosaurus was at least the same size as the biggest Carcharodontosaurus, while likely larger, but broadly within the same category in terms of mass. And yes, its bite force would be over double that of the carcs, but that's not the sole deciding factor in a confrontation over territory or food, given how they'd likely both be going for the sauropods and ornithopods in the region. The first is their skull structures. We know from fossil evidence that Tyrannosaurus fought by attacking the skulls and necks of rivals, biting into faces and brain cases with enough force to crunch through bone, and that they could survive such punishment. Their skulls were incredibly robust and heavily reinforced, selected to tank heavy damage, while Carcharodontosaurus's skull was not adapted for this kind of combat. Its biting power was much weaker, and it was heavily pneumatic, filled with more air pockets. Another point in T-Rex's favor is raw agility. It would be able to turn twice as quickly as its opponent and bite with comparable speed thanks to its massively overdeveloped neck musculature. It also had much more precise and focused binocular vision, letting it judge distances more accurately in combat and helping its bites connect more frequently against a foe of comparable size. So, in the event that these two giants came to blows, T-Rex would be the victor more often than not. Obviously, if you put an adult carc against a subadult Rex, the outcome might be different, but when comparing individuals of similar size, the Tyrant Lizard King has many clear advantages. And here's an important point. While native predators may be able to antagonize young Rexes, T-Rex can do the exact same thing back and with a lot more muscle power. It gets a 7 out of 10 for competition. While there are certainly plenty of other large predators in the area, T-Rex is the most physically powerful and adapted for head-to-head combat, whether that be for herbivores or with other carnivores. Overall, Tyrannosaurus's thrive rate and alive score isn't excellent, but not surprising, 8.3 out of 10. Its disadvantages were few and far between, mainly chalked up to a slight disorientation from changing climates and with a different form of competition than it was used to. T-Rex would thrive here, focusing on fast, relatively agile prey that the Carcharodontosaurus likely couldn't catch. With that in mind, let's dive into speculative evolution. Our first animal is a descendant of Tyrannosaurus, Sahara Tyrant Fulgur. Its name translates to Lightning Desert Tyrant. This Tyrannosaur experienced a phenomenon called pedomorphosis, where it retains the proportions and build of a younger individual in its adult form, and that eventually became the baseline for the genus. Sahara Tyrant is smaller than its ancestor, with adults weighing in between 5 and 7 tons. And while it retained a tyrannosaurian build in terms of skull morphology, sacrificed much of the raw power of T-Rex for speed and agility. Its hip and leg muscles are proportionally larger, with a more powerfully built caudofemoralis muscle to further reduce rotational inertia. It overall resembles a huge albertosaurian, and can reach speeds of 35 miles an hour or 56 kilometers an hour, maintaining such paces for miles thanks to its bird-like respiratory system. Sahara Tyrant represents a hypothetical branch of Tyrannosaurian that specialized in the ornithopods of the Kem Kem, focusing on chasing them down in coordinated groups of 3 to 5 individuals and exhausting their prey before taking them down. They'll occasionally take other prey like young sauropods, but typically leave that niche to Carcharodontosaurus, which has its own spec Evo descendant here, Carcharodontosaurus titanolethros, the shark-toothed titan-bane lizard. This theropod, once the ornithopods became the main prey item of the invasive tyrannosaurs, went full tilt into the sauropod hunter territory. Its dentary tilted forward and down slightly, gaining extra bony reinforcement as a tool for holding on tightly to sauropod flanks and sides, with longer incisiform teeth in that area. Since it didn't need to focus on speed at all, it was selected for thicker skin and wide osteoderms to protect it from the lashing tails and glancing blows of the sauropods it hunted. Titan banes are big, too. Fully skeletally mature adults typically are 12 to 13.5 meters long, and mass anywhere from 8 to 10 tons. They focused on stability rather than agility, with shorter legs contributing to a lower center of gravity. They approach sauropods from the sides and latch on, ripping out huge chunks of flesh to immediately cripple their prey while their thicker integument protects them from counterattack. Thanatosuchus sapiens is the first Spec Evo crocodilian on the channel, and I love this little guy. By little, I mean 3 to 4 meters long and 200 to 400 kilograms, of course. Thanatosuchus is a descendant of Araripusuchus, and was selected for both intelligence and speed as it adapted to the presence of Sahara Tyrant. Thanatosuchus, or the Wise Death Crocodile, has formed a mutualistic relationship with the fast Tyrannosaurs. They themselves can gallop at high speeds across the deserts and wetlands, thanks to their long columnar legs, webbed hooved feet, and stabilizing tails. Their patterns mimic Carcharodontosaurus to cause alarm, and they can also produce deep screams that startle herds of ornithopods into running away. The sound doubles as a summons that brings Sahara Tyrants to the hunt. In exchange, Wise Deaths are permitted to scavenge on carcasses that Sahara Tyrants kill, and even sometimes sleep near Sahara Tyrant nests for protection from other large predators. I'm interested to see where that community goes in the future, given how closely it resembles the relationship between some wolves and corvids. Thanks for watching! Don't forget to download Beastlord using my link in the description and pinned comment, and use the code BL777 for help with early development. Let me know what other Thrive or Eaten Alive scenarios you'd like to see, and don't forget to check out the first episode of the Quashny Trials over on the Overseer's channel. If you liked the hybrid war, you'll love hybrids versus aliens. Feel free to join the Raptor level of the channel to gain loyalty badges and shoutouts, and if you're really hardcore, you can gain early access to videos at the Megatheropod level. I'm the Vividen, and I'll see you the next time Tyrannosaurus rolls up to solo an ecosystem.